Gearhart's back.
The more things change, the more they stay the same.
From NJ1015.com, this is the new Jim Gearhart Podcast.
Come with us to the thrilling days of yesteryear, when out of the West rode, how did they do that? The Great Horse Silver, I remember the Lone Ranger.
Oh, gosh, yeah, that was...
Yeah. Yeah. Well, in our last gripping episode... Oh, I got to start. I'm Jim Gearhart, Bob Williams, of course.
Hello.
I got to start with a quote, and I'll do this without comment. H.L. Mencken, the great American writer and wit, once wrote during a presidential election campaign back in the 20s, and he was commenting on the fact, really, that many Americans, plain Americans, wanted a president who was something like them. You've heard that before, yeah. Bob, and right. You've seen that. I want a president. And Mencken says, on some great and glorious day, the plain folk of the land will reach their heart's desire, and the White House will be adorned by a downright moron. I said do that without comment. Now, moving right along.
Sorry, I didn't follow your instructions.
No, you're not supposed to respond to that. I mean, it's just a Mencken thing here. You know, one thing that did get me, this is the 22nd of November. Mm-hmm. I have been amazed, and I don't know how long this has been going on, but I don't remember it before, absolutely no media mention or attention given to the Kennedy assassination, which happened on this day in
1963.
56
years ago.
Yeah.
I think last year was a huge anniversary, the 55th year.
Oh, really?
So perhaps since this is not a big year as far as like a calendar year, that
in fact,
it's not getting as much attention as last year.
American history is in something of a sort of déclassé now to media.
But to many who live through it or students of history, it's a solemn day. Today is one of the saddest days in our country's history.
Well, this is the big day that people say you always remember where you were and what you were doing. This is the biggie.
Yeah.
I mean, we have 9/11. We have a lot of other things.
And where were you back on December?
I was working in Pittsburgh at the time, and I was in a dental chair in the office of Dr. Nicholas Batar, and he had at least two hands in my mouth. Sometimes it felt like more. Working, well, we had a radio on, and there was a radio station that played good music, if you want, not classical, but in every town at that time, there was always a radio station that played sort of elevator music.
Right, there was a Top 40, there was a beautiful music station.
There was a beautiful music station. Beautiful music in the air everywhere over Pittsburgh. But anyway, the radio was on, and we heard the bulletin come in. And of course, everything stopped, and we were listening, and so... It was so fast, the developments that you got, that very quickly there was a report from CBS that the president had died. So Dr. Batar went over, opened up a drawer, like they have in a dental, pulled out a bottle of Johnny Walker Red Label, took two of those little cups, you know, the little paper cups. Rinse cups. Put one in front of me on his little
Like a shot glass?
And one on his, and we sat there. Spent the rest of the, an hour or so just sitting there, thunderstruck, almost paralyzed, just drinking the scotch. That was quite a weekend. Then
did you have to go to work? And
I do morning shows, and that was after the morning.
Okay,
I was through for the day.
So this was a Friday, right?
It was a Friday, so I didn't have to go back. But then Saturday morning, you remember. Now, there was a big debate. I guess it was Sunday.
The football game.
The football game.
Yeah,
there was a big. This is in Pittsburgh at Forbes Field. The Steelers were scheduled to play the Chicago Bears, and there was a big debate on whether NFL football should be played that Sunday. I think it ended up that some games went on, some didn't. This one did, fortunately, because the feeling was it'll take people's mind off this.
Yes.
And I do remember getting up, getting dressed to go to the game with the television on, and all of a sudden here was this scene of Lee Harvey Oswald getting shot by Jack Ruby.
On that Sunday afternoon.
Just before we got in the car to go out. And memories that stick with you. And I remember during the ball game, sitting there watching the game, And there was an amazing play by a tight end, former University of Pittsburgh person, whom you may have heard of today, not terribly at the time, a tight end for the Chicago Bears named Mike Ditka, who caught a pass and made the most amazing run that thinks still I've ever seen in my life. I don't know, for some reason these things all hang together, these memories.
Yeah, and if I recall reading that the commissioner of the NFL, Pete Rozelle, interviewed years later, saying that was probably one of the biggest mistakes that he made as commissioner in allowing those games to be played on that Sunday.
I wonder why. Because I don't remember they got any particular flack about it. People were stunned.
I think
people were too stunned to be.
But you can't blame them for
angry about one petty thing or another.
You can't blame them for wanting to have some sort of diversion for the population. But there again, the magnitude probably didn't hit people like it did. Everyone was in shock by what happened.
It was probably an amazing time. Who's that? Nicholas says, good morning from North Carolina. Well, good morning right back.
How's the weather down there, Nick?
It's
a little bit. I
think it's raining like everything down there.
We're going to get a little bit of everything.
Oh, I've got to tell you something. This doesn't do anything newsy, but to me it is. There is a series on public television, PBS. This is by far the best done series I've seen in, 50 years of television watching. Have you seen any part of this called Country Music?
Yes, I did.
It is incredible.
That's the Ken Burns series, right?
It's a Ken Burns series.
Yeah.
And I think there's 10 of them. I think
I've seen a few.
Seven.
Yes, they're incredible.
I watched one through six three times.
So you've seen the one with Roger Miller and...
Oh, yes. I've seen all of that. But what struck me is not... I was never a country music fan. Never played at a country music radio station. Always thought I detested it. Until you come back and you find out and you see what a big part of your life it was. Things that I picked up and knew that I never thought I did. A lot of it goes back when they were a kid. Going down on Saturday night and lying on the hoses in the back of the fire truck in the local firehouse with sort of a community gathering, and everybody sat there and listened to the Grand Ole Opry. Well, it certainly didn't make me a great fan or anything, but that's what we did. But things that you pick up. But I think more importantly, or to me as important as the music, was the background, the setting, the photography of an era through which I lived and I remember. And I was growing up at the time as a young child down in the very southern part of Virginia. And it was rife with that music. Flat and Scruggs, were local guys and the like.
Well, it looks like Janice can understand what we're talking about. Janice is from Arkansas.
Okay, Janice...
Is that Arkansas or Arkansas?
I just say, and I guess the reason I brought it up, or people, especially people who have some connection to that, you will be amazed by some of the background shots they have, the scenery.
Oh, from the series.
They'd show footage, Jim.
Yeah.
They would show these places where some of these singers were born, these cabins, and I would swear I've seen it because there were so many of them. I didn't see that particular one. But they were still down there the whole time I was growing up there. You could go out and the hillbillies.
Yes.
And I knew these people intimately, not the singers, but of course, but the culture. My father was the town manager, little town in Virginia. And he would put me out from the time I was about 14 working with the street gangs, during school vacations. And the school, the street crews, the Department of Public Works, was made up by the local hillbillies, really. And I got to know these people, live with
some
them.
Dirt, yeah.
I got to ride around, and most of the stuff I did was riding around the truck picking up brush. I had to do the garbage truck every now and again. And we always had a mason jar of moonshine down on the floor between the seats. And so I never realized that I was part of that culture. Because you get away from it and you go up, you go off to other things and other climes. And Nicholas says, used to listen every day to you till I moved out in 2016. I guess it's North Carolina.
Yeah, that Nick from North Carolina.
Temperature up to 69 today.
Nick, why did you leave New Jersey? like we probably don't know.
Right? Nick, tell me it's really a good thing to do because, you know, we all sit here and contemplate that.
Yeah.
Every time the property tax business comes around.
I presume Nick is very happy down there in NC.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But some of the music, too, especially that crossed over because I was playing. I remember, for example, working in Pittsburgh and doing a morning show. And we were also in the process of renovating an old farmhouse we'd bought up north of town in a place called Gibsonia, up near Mars, Pennsylvania. Mm. Remember Mars?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Radio stations. There's a little town north of Pittsburgh called Mars.
Broadcasting from Mars.
And radio stations all over the country used to have these contests. You could win a free trip to Mars. Without telling anybody
what it was.
Yeah. And I guess it was named after the Mars family, the Mars Candy Company.
Right.
It was named after, I forget his first name, Mars.
Which has a facility up in Hackettstown, New Jersey.
Exactly.
M&M Mars.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But anyway, I can remember so distinctly KDK, which was the huge radio station there. They played pops during the day.
The Westinghouse station.
Yeah. The big Westinghouse station. And I could remember just the thrill and goosebumps when I'd be working away at this old house and all of a sudden here would pop on the Skeeter Davis, End of the World.
Mm.
And the big one, the really big one that got me, and man, I still get shiver thinking about this, was parking my car in the morning at the parking garage, and all of a sudden it was very quiet walking in, and all of a sudden, bang, on the radio, here comes, bum, I can't stop loving you, the Ray Charles. And that's, I still, thinking about that, I can get a goosebump thinking about Ray Charles. So these things, and they have great shots of that. You ever meet Ray Charles?
No.
I met him then during the heyday of that. They used to have what they call beer and cheese parties, the local record pluggers. Now, the record plugging kind of got into disrepute during payola scandals back in the 60s. And so I came in on the cusp of it. The guy doing the show I did before, when he left, he went, I think, to ABC. And he had gotten, payola. He had a new Ford station wagon. Well, managers used to tell you go in and, what does the job pay? And they say, well, it pays about $250 a week, but you can get $500, $600 in payola.
To offset.
And this was top 40 radio, so you'd have a stack of 40 little 45s. And you play the one on the top, take it off, put it on the bottom, play the next one on the top. And so that's the way it worked. But anyway, they had these parties and for stars. So you got to meet every star because these people were constantly traveling in the old days, not just the country, but the pop people too. So you'd have and you get to meet them. But I can remember Ray Charles, and especially when Ray Charles flew in, that was in the heyday of the big country album he made, I Can't Stop Loving You. Mm-hmm. And I remember Ray Charles because you see him later, he was very thin, extremely thin, and very, very affable. He came in and he walked around. What they did, we knew he was coming, we didn't know when, but all of a sudden a door opened and here that song boomed in, and here comes this little, very thin person with his pilot was with him. And he went around the room, and he would come up and introduce himself to everybody. Hi, I'm Ray Charles. Well, we were saying, oh, my God, we know who you are. I'm stunned. But and I had nice conversations with him.
Have you seen the biopic years ago with Jamie Foxx, who portrayed Ray Charles?
No.
I believe he either won for the Academy Award, or he was definitely nominated.
Uh-huh.
Excellent portrayal. It's about maybe about 10, 12 years ago. If you haven't seen, I'm sure it's on demand. Just basically call Ray.
My conversation with Ray Charles was about flying. Mm-hmm. He loved flying, and he had a pilot, and he had a plane. And the pilot would let him fly the plane. The pilot said that his sense of what sound, number one, but also of attitude, spatial orientation, was so great that he could pretty much fly the airplane by listening and feeling. Mm-hmm. The old fly by the seat of your pants thing, by feel. And I doubt that he ever let him land. But otherwise, once you were up there, and he could do maneuvers and everything, he loved it. So quite a person. I guess my other one, I'm getting carried away here, because we did at least get acquainted with and talk to about everybody who was big in the early 60s in music. One of my favorites was the night that I got to spend a half hour with Ella Fitzgerald.
Mm.
Ella Fitzgerald had a record out at the time, and she was coming down to one of these parties at the Carlton House, the hotel in Pittsburgh, and she was late. And what happened was that she was up in a room watching The Untouchables, and she was determined she was not going to get out of the room until she saw the end of the program. Well, they pushed her to come out early, and I don't know if she missed the end of the program or not, but I know we were standing there when Ella Fitzgerald came into actually an adjacent room. And so we knew that she was in there, but nobody kind of went in because we weren't sure. She didn't look like she was the happiest person in the world sitting there. And then out of it came up one of the people who had been with her. His was a journalist, an African-American journalist named George Pitt, if I'm not mistaken, that I've become very friendly with. So George came over to me for some reason or other and sort of got me aside and said, "How'd you and your wife like to come in and meet Ella?" And I said, "My God, of course we would." So we go in and we sit down, and one of us on either side. And she and Sue, my wife, they got in this great conversation, family and kids. The typical things you do with you know, women who get to, matrons who get together,
yeah.
and had such a great time. And finally, she ended up, I guess, relenting and went into the room and got lionized and everything. But we got to sit there the longest time.
Nice.
So things like that happen. And to see a program that covers music during that era with all of these people in there is just amazing. So I would suggest to you that...
Oh, those Ken Burns series are incredible.
Yeah.
He did the one on baseball. He's done the one on history, New York City. Oh, he's done countless ones. And just they're all very well done.
Okay, Doug says, coming to New Jersey next week for Thanksgiving from Florida to visit the children and grandchildren, will it be safe? I don't know, Doug.
It'll be expensive, more expensive than Florida.
It would be more expensive than if you moved your children to Iowa.
We must do what we must do.
Yeah.
Rosemarie
says, move from New Jersey to Delaware. That's not very far. Love it here. I only miss New Jersey because my kids are there. That's kind of cheating, moving to Delaware.
It's just,
of course, they don't have sales tax in Delaware.
It's like a $5 toll, that's all it is.
Yeah.
Don't tell anybody, otherwise they'll up that toll on the Delaware Bridge.
Yeah. Oh, what else is going on? I'm sorry.
Getaway week for Thanksgiving, as people were talking about. And we're doing this on Friday the 22nd, so a lot of people are staggering. I mean, traditionally, the Wednesday before Thanksgiving is the most heavily traveled day of the year, followed by the Sunday after Thanksgiving. Those are the big travel days. But I think people have learned their lesson, especially at the airports and somewhat on the roads, that they're staggering their travel plans. I mean, you're going to see a lot more people traveling over this weekend if they can afford to take the extra time off at the airport or for a long-distance trip. A lot of people are even taking that Wednesday off before Thanksgiving to get their day started or traveling on Tuesday. We've seen a lot of late Tuesday afternoon travel. That's the big travel day.
I'm surprised we can still have Thanksgiving, that you don't have groups out there trying to intimidate you out of it, because the pilgrims were no doubt racists or lookists or whatever the pilgrims were.
Yeah.
They weren't progressive, I think. Anyway.
But it's a special Thanksgiving this year because Eric Scott's Buffalo Bills are playing on Thanksgiving. They're playing the Cowboys, and the Bills are actually doing pretty well
this year.
Doing
very, very well.
So, go Bills.
Just looking at some of the things here, I don't know if I mentioned it now, but I've spent the early part of the week very sick.
Yes,
and
that's why we're here
today.
Still
a little bit weak.
Gave you an extra day
instead of Thursday.
Recover,
Trying to recover. I don't know what it is. It was the damnedest illness I think I've ever had. For 3 days, I could hardly get out of bed. And yesterday, when I finally said, I got to do something, and I put my 40-pound leaf blower on my back and went out and blew leaves.
Sweated it off.
And I wish somebody had taken a picture of it, because I was trying to balance myself. I was so weak. And I must have looked like some kind of a weird dance, some kind of a ritual thing going on there, back and forth. Looked like one of the mummers, you know, how they walk.
Yes.
Two steps forward and three back.
Oh, gosh.
And so with it. I think...
Some hot topics this week?
Well, I think, to me, the Chick-fil-A throwing in the towel was rather disappointing.
Yeah, well, they were, they're not going to donate to some of their...
Salvation Army.
What's the reason for that?
Well, the reason for that is that the usual, the alphabet group, these intimidators, have successfully intimidated them into not giving money to an organization that this group didn't approve of. Now,
Salvation Army apparently
did not bring the owners of Chick-fil-A to their knees by claiming that they were actually Christians, which was a terrible thing to them, because some Christian doctrine does not support their agenda.
But Salvation Army, that is a pretty well-respected group that...
Well, the Salvation Army is a Christian organization.
Well, right up there with the Red Cross, I mean, as far as the good that they do. And, you know, during times of, you know, terrible tragedy and, you know, catastrophe...
That doesn't
Who are you going to donate to?
That
doesn't
matter.
Donate to the Red Cross and then the Salvation Army.
They crossed the mob. They did not support this particular revenge agenda that everybody's supposed to support. Or you will be annihilated. Hmm. You know, it's gotten so bad that even President Obama, and I think I mentioned this last week, has tried to urge moderation on these groups,
right,
telling them that you're not going to do anything but create a backlash by this constant intimidation.
Right.
Now, the what interests me was how the government allows people to be intimidated into accepting somebody else's idea of whom they can give to and to whom they cannot give.
Right.
That is completely illegal. Now, suppose that a group tried to stop you from making charitable donations to a Muslim organization. The government would have your butt in jail if you tried to intimidate people. So a religious intimidation is totally unconstitutional. And yet here this is being done every day by a group that is getting away with it. And I have absolutely no difficulty with the people, their behavior, what they want to do, rights they have gained, God bless you, more power to you. But there comes a time when you're using it for purposes of intimidation simply out of my motivation for revenge, and in my view, this is what it is, then I think this is something that is totally in violation of our constitutional rights. In other words, by the same extension, Bob, you wanted to give money to the Boy Scouts.
Mm-hmm.
If your desire to do that was so large, they could come well after you.
Yes, they could.
And they've certainly come after the Scouts.
And then how do you really
know? But everybody
know?
Backs down.
But there again, how if they came after you, which is a possibility, how do you know that they're coming after you?
Because they're standing out there screaming in the doors of your businesses and urging people, trying to keep people away. That's how you'd know. So again, I mean, this is the thing. I get so upset with the irrational behavior.
Yeah.
To some extent, I can organize. I can understand it or appreciate it. In my vision, anyway, I think here is an alliance of people who, for many years, had every cause given to them by society for feeling bad about themselves, and you cannot help but build up resentment. And then suddenly, you find yourself in the catbird seat, and you're in a culture. I don't know that this has ever happened before in history. For the entirety of history, go back recorded history, 3,500 years if you want, these particular activities have been considered, sin in cultures that had sin. It was considered acceptable activity in others, punishable by the most stringent of punishments. And then this is right up until a generation ago.
Yeah.
You could go to jail for this. All of a sudden, the things for which people could go to jail and for which the brain structure of the population had been sort of developed to oppose, all of a sudden, like clear blue out of nowhere, it's gone from a pariah status to some holy sanctity.
Yes.
And so it's gone, the activity has gone from a crime and a sin to a sanctity is not the word that I'm looking for right now. But anyway, to some kind of a holy act. Yeah. And everybody is intimidated into going along with it. I think the problem here is we have had a change, a huge cultural change this is, in a short period of time. And just to try to do this in outline form, because God knows I'm not really capable of getting into it that much, I think there is a scientific reason for aversion to that, because from the time that people are about 7 years old, you are programmed by the environment,
yes,
by the culture, and certainly by family.
Social stimulation, and all of those factors.
Yes, but your brain is formed. All the neural pathways, the billions of them in there, the little routes that thoughts take, that incidents take, and are connected to responses, these are hardwired into this unconscious, subconscious, or what have you. And it's very difficult to get up one day and say, oh, well, that's not right. I'll change it. In fact, there's a whole industry grown up right now trying to figure out some way and get people to somehow reprogram their subconscious. Mm-hmm. How many people are buying these CDs? Have you seen those? I mean, the market is teeming with them. And they have these subliminal messages in. And this programs you. They have one for anxiety, for example.
Right.
And you, Dan, you're familiar with
the MP3s.
These.
Yeah.
And help me with some words here. There's a term for those. Do you remember the? And it's a big thing. Also, there are several movements now, and some of which people pay good money to go off to seminars and the like. And the trick is to overcome anxiety and overcome stress.
Transcendental meditation, maybe?
Well, that's part of it. That was one of the early ones, was meditation. But meditation, all of these involve meditation, yes. Now, I guess to buttress my point, the reason that we have that is the human mind works because of its programming. As Buddha pointed out, it's like little monkeys hopping around in a tree and you can't stop them. And so for anybody who's ever tried, you ever try meditation, Dan?
Okay, once or twice.
He does it in the car.
Bob?
Occasionally, deep breathing.
And I bet I can predict why it didn't work terribly well for you, because the brain won't stop.
Yeah.
And go into
You've
this.
You've got to completely stop. Yeah.
It just goes Absolutely. On and on and on and on. And some rock artist, and I don't know the name of a song or what, once had the line, he said, "Someone else is inside my head and I don't know who it is." But the point is that we have this subconscious down there programmed and all these, mechanically almost, with the neurological shenanigans that are going on in there. So getting back to the point, these judgments, these value judgments, are locked into people. And there was no attempt to overcome, I think it used to be known as future shock, back when history was happening so fast the human mind wasn't geared to absorb it and to deal with it. So all of these changes are going on without any thought to, well, maybe we should be patient with this and give people's brains a chance to absorb the change, and then we'll be okay. But it's like all of a sudden you come in and you get hit with a croquet mallet.
Right.
And
knock some sense into
it. Here it is. Okay, well, that's rambling on and on, but some thoughts about that and where it is.
So the big story this week is the tabling of recreational weed.
Yeah.
I believe the decision's been made to put it on the ballot for next November as a question.
Yeah, the ballot question. That will be, is it this coming November?
Coming November, yep.
Coming November. Now, this is a trick. Not a very good one. As you know, the governor had promised that everybody would have weed up their nose by, 10 days after he...
Right, after he was elected.
A few days after he was elected. This hasn't happened, because the legislature has to pass suitable legislation. They have not done it, and so they've decided to throw in the towel right now. And the way they're doing it is to say, oh, to save face. And I say, save face for the governor, too. We're going to put this on the ballot, then you can decide. Oh, listen, we're going to let the people decide.
They can wash their hands
Democratic.
Of it. Yes.
We can wash our hands of it. Now, it'll go on the ballot, but it'll go on the ballot the way public questions go on the ballot. It'll simply say, I authorize the legislature to meet to come up with legislation with an eye to legalizing marijuana. Well, they've already done that. That's where we were.
Okay, so
we're right back where we started from.
So they just keep kicking the weed down the road.
They kick the can of weed. They kick the tote down the road.
Right, yeah.
And so you're right back where you started again, because no doubt people will again say yes. But don't think that because you say yes, that the day after the election or the day after the inaugurations in January, you're going to be running out there, you know, filling your pockets full of legal weed.
Right.
Because you just, all you're doing is going back through the same process over again.
Right, and they're just taking themselves off the hot seat for the next year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I don't know, you know, the thing with the legal marijuana is that it's still illegal nationally.
Right.
And you could get, conceivably, see, we came close to doing this. The only reason that there was some legalized marijuana was that the Attorney General during the Obama administration had turned his eye to it, and the Justice Department had allowed states to do this by kind of staying out of it. Right. However, there was a possibility during the campaign in 2016 that an anti-marijuana crusader named Chris Christie could have become the Attorney General in a Republican administration. He didn't, but he could have. Therefore, he has said that if he were Attorney General, he would have the national law enforced. Therefore, there would be the end of all of the state marijuana, the medical marijuana and the whole thing, because he was adamantly opposed to it. So we don't know who's going to be elected or reelected or how this will work out. Yeah. But I think it's just good to know that.
Let's just hit on this for a second.
No, I don't want to get into that. Okay. I will do that. There's a couple
do
of things.
Next time.
And I tell you, I've been so damn sick, and my brain is still a little bit, as you heard me rambling on about the Chick-fil-A business. It's just that I dislike seeing any organization or group have the power to intimidate people for perfectly legal behavior. There was the Fellowship of Christian Athletes, and I must say I don't know much about them, except I do know that such an organization did exist, and I guess does exist. That was the other one. Just looking down here at some little small instrumental things as we approach closing time. Mm-hmm. Drink up, everybody. University of Virginia, on Veterans Day, they canceled the 21-gun salute, which was part of the... Well, because they said that the students were too sensitive to gunfire on the campus. And so they could not have a 21-gun salute.
I don't know what to say.
I don't know if anybody asks the students, are you sensitive to that? Do you feel that these military people are going to break rank and come and shoot you? It's highly unlikely. It's highly unlikely they have live ammunition in there anyway. But it just shows how pretty much ridiculous that we have gotten. And I think the school is just making an assumption that the whole student body is cowering in a safe place, being protected from hearing anything, any word that is opposed to whatever their core belief is right now.
But on the positive side, nationally, I think you saw more celebrations and commemorations for Veterans Day than we've had in recent memory.
This is true.
And this is the first time that a sitting president has actually attended the Veterans Day parade in New York City.
Mm-hmm. And a football game.
And made some remarks at it.
Well, I saw the National Football League. I can understand them jumping on the veterans bandwagon because they took a lot of flack last year because of the interferences that were allowed, and I don't know how they could have stopped them, but the interferences that during ball games, during the what the national, the patriotic yeah. part of the program. The I just want to do one more thing here, and I'm not sure because again I don't want to get into this, but this was a recent ruling by the Attorney General's office, as I understand it, that police have to give special careful attention to people who would qualify for this organization we've discussed, whose initials I can never get straight.
LGBTQ.
Yeah. And they have to be treated pretty much, I'm not sure, they didn't say the officer has to genuflect when a person comes in.
But they cannot be gender specific, basically, so when you're addressing.
How they'll teach the police to work around their routines and not mention pronouns, I have no idea, but that's something for them to do. Yeah. But the first thing that popped into my head was a story last week from England, where I think this is already in effect. In England, a police officer lost his job because he could not bring himself to refer to a was person described as 6 feet four, 260 pounds, very muscular with tattoos, a crew cut or bald head, and a long beard as Mary Lou, and address this person as ma'am. It just somehow was not in his programming to do it, and the person had demanded that it be done, and so he got fired. So I can't help but wait and see
how this is going to shake out. I mean,
how the police department.
It seems like it seems right on the surface, and we don't know how it's going to play out, but it seems very complicated.
But it's something you've got to assume with every bit of new regulation like this. And I'll go back to the Americans with Disabilities Act if you want. These things are extremely well-intentioned, and I'm sure this directive is. But all this is going to do is get the ears perk up of lawyers and say, oh my God, look at the fertile ground here for lawsuits. So if a police officer in the crush of duty uses the wrong pronoun and the person wants to complain, therefore, an attorney, I no doubt, can go and sue the police department of the town and anybody else in sight because of violating the law. So things like this will come up. I don't know how they're going to work out. I have no idea. I hope they work out well. I guess, generally speaking, and to make an end of this whole thing, the biggest fear I have is not the ultimate implementation of all manner of special things that may seem somehow curious to us now. It's when is the straw, which one is going to be the straw that breaks the camel's back? And people are going to say, I've had enough. Remember out there that you don't hear this in media and it's kind of brushed aside and you're led to believe that everybody is anti-conservative. But remember, 65 million people voted for Donald Trump. That's a lot of people. And they still turn up at rallies, and they still have a particular mindset. They're still deplorable. And so they are going to be here when this brave new world suddenly is dropped in upon us. And how are they going to respond? I don't know. I'm not suggesting anything, obviously. God knows, not encouraging it. There are something like 15 million assault rifles they have among them out there somewhere or other. And I don't know where this goes. It's like a runaway train right now, heading in this very, very far left direction. And only, I said, you got former President Obama maybe pulling on the cord saying, right, there's a bridge. Look, there could be a bridge out of there, people.
Yeah.
Look at what we've gained. Slow down before you lose it all.
Yeah.
So I don't know. These are things you ponder. And I'm pondering right now, getting some rest and trying to get well. And I hope I haven't infected you.
No.
With whatever.
I think we're good.
The damnedest cold I think I've ever had.
Yeah, you look good, and you're covering it up. If you're still feeling ill, we can't tell. So it's good to have you back.
Well,
and we will be we'll be taking next week off for Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
And we'll be back on 2 weeks from yesterday. So a Thursday, whatever that is, the 29th, the 30th.
And I shall be probably clarifying many issues I talked about today when you could say, 5th. What the hell is he talking about? And I will simply impose upon myself Ludwig Wittgenstein, the great philosopher's line, opening and ending line of his Tractatus Philosophicus, his basic work, Tractatus Philosophicus. Anyway, the Tractatus, in which the opening line says, "Whereof one cannot speak, thereof one should remain silent."
Good words to live by.
If there's any question about whether you know what you're talking about, just sit down and shut up.
Happy Thanksgiving, Jim.
Yeah.
We'll see you on Thursday, December 5th, 10:30 in the morning.
Okay. Okay, let me be responding to something here. Time to hang it up. Human rights for everybody. This has nothing to do with human rights. I would certainly grant and certainly would support human rights in every regard. I do not believe in a human right, though, to intimidate other people simply because you feel that your right is superior to their right, that your right deserves annihilation. Because remember, other people have rights too. I think this has gotten lost in the whole shuffle. Enjoy your rights. God bless you. But then just stop trying to browbeat everybody else into denying their own rights in order to allow you to somehow impose your own on everybody. Okay?
Gearhart's back.
The more things change, the more they stay the same.
From NJ1015.com, this is the new Jim Gearhart Podcast.